some of these lights.
Appreciate that. I think, folks, what we'll, can everybody hear me okay? All right, I'm kind of a soft-spoken guy because when I'm in the studio environment, we work real closely with our students, and you get used to that, you know. But I think what's helped me over the years is to have to lecture and teaching art history and art appreciation, which, you know, some people tire of teaching, but to be honest with you, I love it. I get a lot of mileage out of it. We also have more students in that area, too. It's, you know, it's good. Okay. I think what I'm going to do is read a few things, just a few career highlights, not to, you know, stoke my fires here or whatever, but my ego, but just to give you a little idea of what makes someone interested in visual art. We all have things that happen to us in life. Maybe there's a musician, or perhaps people get into theater, whatever the case may be, because somebody has exposed them to that, right? Has opened their mind up to that potentiality. Fortunately, that happened to me. I'll just speak a little bit away from my prepared lecture. I'm going to give you a prepared one because sometimes you want to share my testimony. I actually read it, and then you're not here like a preacher for about 3 hours. You know, I'll sort of shortcut that. Okay, but I think the long and short for me was the influences of teachers really at a young age. I'll elaborate on that later on. But when I was 12, I was raised in St. Louis, Missouri, and my parents. It was one of those, you know, parents-teacher conferences that we all love to go to. I had to do it as a parent myself of four children. And we got them through, thank goodness. Still raising them, but in their 20s. But at any rate, I remember my principal in Lutheran parochial school. I was in Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. And we had a lot of Germans. I mean, it was just very ethnocentrically German in those days. So they didn't mess around. We got the Board of Education, not the Board of Education in town, but the one with the holes drilled in it. Mm-hmm. That kind of Board of Education. Right? Literal Board of Education. So at any rate, Mr. Soul, believe it or not, S-O-H-L, and Mr. Soul said to my mother, "This kid can't handle math, but he loves to draw." You know, and there it was. So encourage him. Get him in art school, whatever the case may be. Maybe he'll pick up math later. I didn't, but that's another story. Okay. That's one reason I'm standing here, too. Another one is my mother really wanted me to go to Lutheran High School pretty badly. And she sacrificed enough for the parochial education, but she said, "I don't know, won't you keep me?" And I said, "Mom," I said, "I'll be in a bubble if I'm going to do that. And all my buddies are going to, you know, public high school, so I wanted to go there too." Well, lo and behold, my homeroom teacher was an artist. Even my football coach was an artist. I couldn't get away from art. He told me I cried. So that told me a little something later on in life that I think sometimes I may get a call to whatever profession. Also, we hear that a lot in the spiritual realm, but it's always a profession to do, and to do your best with it, whatever you. There's always a pretty few to do my first here, and then some. These are. Let me just write a few highlights. And by the way, to do my website, which is my web. I hate like that. You know, just check it. You know, website. Hey, website. Uh-huh. Who's here? It's just here's my website. David E. Harmon, studioart.com. My name. And Harmon, don't look at stuff. David E. Harmon. I've been to notice, like Mark Harmon in the obituary. Was it the old twain of, you know, Leth is saying, great, exaggerated. My dad, I'm still standing, so don't worry about this. Traveling accident, you know, Vincent Van Gogh was painting to the St. Louis City Art Museum in the 1970s, solidified my decision to become a painter. I did 34 years of uninterrupted college and university teaching experience at 9 schools, both nationally and internationally. I've taught 90 different visual art courses at several different schools, and I've created several art courses in both art history and studio art categories. I didn't plan on that, by the way. I wanted to go to a school, get tenured, stay there, and retire. It didn't happen. I met and received critique from West Coast painter Wayne Thiebaud in 1980, and I've always loved his work. He's in his 90s now. I met and interviewed several New York City artists, including Elaine and Willem de Kooning, Alice Neal, Philip Perlstein, and Ivram Lasso. The highlight was the visit to Cooney. He was my hero, the American Picasso, you might say. You know, a lot of notoriety there. I personally organized and led 10 international student trips to Europe, France, Greece, Ireland, Italy, Germany, so on and so forth. I've organized and experienced an international professorial exchange in Liverpool, England. And I've had my work exhibited in 128 galleries, museums, and art centers in both group and solo exhibitions. I met Robert Hughes, critic art Robert Hughes, on the occasion of his lecture at the Savannah College of Art and Design in 2007. He passed away in 2012, a great loss in the critical world of art. A few other things here. I've organized plein air field painting excursions for students to many locales in the US and the UK. And I've been privileged to have visited and studied the great masters whose work is in the great museums of the world. Folks, if you're going to get into visual art, you have to see art. You have to see art in churches. You have to see art in museums and in galleries. And I love one great quote from a book called The Shape of Content by Ben Shahn. And one thing he said in there that's always stuck out, take all seriousness seriously. That's pretty hard in our culture because we're a culture of parody. You know, everything's a joke. And we know that that's not the case all the time, is it? There's some things that are quite serious and we have to mull them over and ponder them. And I do that quite a bit in my work. Before I paint, I think a lot, you know, and then I go for it, okay, with my brush, the old-fashioned one. I've made it a point to read and have taught from some of the best books on art, H.H. Arneson, John Berger, who's about 90, he just wrote a book on drawing, Betty Edwards, Peter Fuller, you name it, Robert Henry, and so on and so forth. I've had the privilege to have been a student of the following artist teachers, Stuart Frost, Leon Hicks, Sister Gabriel Mary Horaire, Jack Canepa, Richard Mayhew, and Philip Saltz. These professionals encouraged my tenacity in my painting by being critical, open, and above all, encouraging me in my journey. You don't know those people, but I do. And they're all alive. And that's really nice, too. I'm 62 years old, and they're still kicking. That's great. I have a few quotes. One is one of my favorite quotes. While we do not see, look at the things which you're seeing, not the things which are all contemporary, from some things which are seen or current. I think Corinthians is a verse 18. Because I see teaching students very important, but also not only because I have to teach this and these things, but really also because dialogue comes out. See what you still believe one, at a dialogue, find things. Art has something even secret being around dog. That's so, this really learn from people. My favorite quote, true, until I die. What is the way it is? Well, it's because when you're from St. Louis, the first thing I know about St. Louis is the first Louis in my ask is, where did you go to high school? Well, I don't know why, but that's the question you ask. And we find that out. I don't know why. Yeah. It is evident that St. Louis affected me more deeply than any environment has ever had. I feel there's something in having passed one's childhood beside the big river, which is incommunicable to those people who have not. I consider myself fortunate to have been born here rather than Boston, New York, or London. That was T.S. Eliot, by the way. He who works with his hands is a laborer. He who works with his hands and head is a craftsman. He who works with his hands and head and his heart is an artist. St. Francis of Assisi. The mediator of the inexpressible is the work of art. That was Goethe. And a great quote from one of my favorite contemporary painters, Anselm Kiefer. I believe art has to take responsibility, but it should not be, giving up being art. And one of my favorite filmmakers, in the end, the test of a work of art is our affection for it, not our ability to explain why it's good, Stanley Kubrick. Art is never finished, only abandoned, Leonardo da Vinci. Change and decay all around I see, Henry Light, in case you don't know it, that's the great hymn, Abide With Me. I see that today, by the way. Art enables us to find ourselves and lose ourselves at the same time, Thomas Merton. The art of the artist must be his own art. It is always a continuous chain of little inventions, little technical discoveries of one's own. In one's relationship to the tool, the materials, and colors, Camille Paglia, art is a vast, ancient, interconnected webwork, a fabricated tradition. Over-concentration on any one part is a distortion. Art reflects on and resolves the eternal human dilemma of order versus energy. Some of my pictures are truly mysterious to me, which is why I often say, I don't know and I don't care what they're really about. And yet I also say, the paintings are prayers, and they have little to do with whatever it is that makes you want more than what daily life affords. Susan Rothenberg. One of my favorite jazz musicians is Horace Silver, and it took me years to find the lyrics to Happy Medium, but I'm going to read these to you. This way or that, which way should I go? To find a happy medium would help me, I know. I need someone to show me the road, to find a happy medium to lighten my load. If you came along to show me the way, to find a happy medium to brighten my day. Thank you, my friend, for being so kind. I found a happy medium right here in my mind. And the final quote is one of the unsung heroes of abstract expressionism, Tchaikovsky. I planned in a hoax to arrive at a painting style in which playing does not include intuitive movement and play. In both means, also distinct off between painting pictures, between Cezanne and Picasso. When I have to choose between them, ideas is painting. If I have to choose between painting and I choose theater, painting. Between painting and form of theater, I choose to do that. I'm a painter. And I fully agree. What is, read this, okay, thank you. That's what I like to do, is to you. Our mind is a big water. Mentor, I need that. Growing art, modernist structure, doors, and teeth, enough with art. Architect, put this to design, did want to be one of those. Now, when it goes together, I just kind of give heating with slides, and get the kind of review. That's what's really serious. Gallery, I'll be honest. And I get some extra slides. I'll kind of pull out this with you. Detail. My wife heard things. In West, okay, St. Louis. Believe me, and I are from Millie and Chicago's Boston perspective. These both had early influences, included by our city, cultural menaces, the art. And these include Chicago, St. Louis, DM City, Art Institute. DM's of all going the same influential key art enthusiast. He's encouraged, always been infidus to the young art and life out. Our teachers have been motivated to work, draw from our masturbation. And other included teaching age programs that John influences Maggie should be. And I was designing this paper, both personal experience and research from both experts. I'm a painter and educator, not a historian. Yet I should cue that we have lived and still do portions of modernism as a people live and can relate to much of it. My focus is on the instrument of modernism, that is the machine. It's reflected in art, appliances, architecture, and design. And it's the pulse, like a heart, if you will, and that is both a symbol in the visual arts and an actual pragmatic object in the industrial consumer realm. Art should have form and content. The machine should be both beautiful, have form, and utilitarian, have function, is a given. Machines have changed in our contemporary culture. Many are digital instead of analog. Use less power and still be powerful and still be cheaper to make machines that are making other machines, hence robotics. And yet humans are still necessary to maintain, at least for now, these humanoids. This is a kind of a funny slide. It actually was, y'all remember the 50s, I was born in 53, so I grew up in the Cold War era, where our medical guides actually had nuclear preparedness. Yeah, sure. And, duck and cover and get in the basement. I'm sure that'll keep us from radiation, right? But that's the culture we grew up in. This is actually a slide from the, or an image from the Saturday Evening Post in the late 50s. And it was actually a critical slide that was gathered by a Russian that was doing research on America. And it's an interesting thing because here we have this young couple, and what are they dreaming about? Well, they're going to get married, and all the stuff they could buy. Talk about early consumerism, right, and materialism.
Babies, dogs.
And there it is. We got everything we need here. So this is one of those slides. I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri, in a working class home in the 50s and 60s, and I experienced firsthand the aspect of modernist change. Let's see if I can get to that next one. I guess I have to look at it to do it. Sorry about that. And some of you may have one of these around. Okay, I'm one of the first generation blunders here. Okay. We basically were in a very old home. I did some research on our home for this. Our home was built 1900, a solid brick home. And, so I'm sure it'll last another 116 years or more here. But machines were always all around me. I operated heavy equipment and experienced the awesome power of my mechanized world. Sometimes I felt diminutive in size, considering the sheer scale of these gargantuan machines I work with. A lot of them were factory jobs. The assembly line would have been lost without them. My parents lived in the same house as did two generations before them. It was a well-constructed house with architectural hints of the old world. And it seemed old-fashioned to me. The interior walls contained wallpaper of various designs, none of which matched, including the stuffed antique furniture, which, by the way, you could fall asleep in very comfortably. Just don't fall asleep right now. But I remember those old chairs. Boy, you just blink in there, and you're out like a light. Later on, I would cite this influence in a series of patterned interior paintings I did. Ironically, this turn-of-the-century home was equipped with several modernist appliances, including streamlined juicers, cake mixers, meat cutters, a freezer from the 1930s that died in the 1970s after 45 continuous years of operation. How about that? Can we get that today? I'm not sure.
Okay. From China.
Here's another funny image here, and that is, and during World War II, I'll read about this, with the war still raging. Once again, the Saturday Evening Post ran a strange cartoon depicting a couple looking at illustrations of appliances hung on what appeared to be a museum wall. It appears as though they would rather buy or dream about buying one of these streamlined appliances rather than to visit an art museum. But here we've got a reproduction of the latest dryer and blah, blah, blah. It is a very bizarre cartoon, there's no doubt about that. We were in the modern world, from the Jetsons cartoons on TV. TV opened up another world for us, and the next couple of slides here, move forward, and this was it, television. Okay, one-way communication in those days. Some people think indoctrination too, whatever. Okay, it was interesting. I just want to go aside here just a little bit, and I'm really focusing on the time. But I don't know if anybody's ever seen plastic tulip furniture. We had next door neighbors that had the first plastic tulip furniture. They always had the latest stuff. And I was afraid to sit on it because it was wobbly. And so I said, what's this made out of? He goes, plastic. I said, but it's going to break, isn't it? He goes, no, not yet. We've had this stuff for over a year. So that's kind of started it, you know, the whole plastics trend, if you will. The TV pretty much was, you know, in our household, just black and white. We couldn't afford color. It's one of the first generations there as well. I want to defer a little bit to another influence in my life, and that, of course, was the denomination of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod here. This is the church I grew up in here. It was a neo-Gothic design church here. Not overly elaborate, good stained glass, as most churches would have in that time. But what I loved was the sanctuary. Inside this church, there's stained glass. There's a crucifix up in the front there. And the little baptistry, the infant baptistry right here, was carved from Carrara marble, the same marble that Michelangelo had used. And I found that out later on. So that made an impression on me Sunday to Sunday as a young person. But here is what really did for me. learn to draw. By the way, the drawing kit is still available if you want it to. I can retro it. It's appropriate there. I used to watch this program religiously, even if it aired from 1950 to 1955. They re-aired John Kilby's program. His program here. Let me read the annual quote here. Andy Warhol said, I learned to draw children. Warhol said, I watched this show every week when I bought all of his bulks under Nagy, using say, bulk cycle cube, cylinder cone. Using these four shapes, I can draw any picture I want, so can you. So this is a cute idea. There was another thing that's kind of cute too, and that is some of these. You know, I think they're still around.
Yes.
If you can draw this, you should be an artist. By the way, you should go to high school. And you can see the competitions, would get you maybe a couple of books, maybe. Many years, right? Between those days, that was maybe my situation. In high school, I said before, my football coach was an artist, right, so on and so forth. Also in the 60s, about 1967, this is, you may recognize this price here, and Vincent Price, or Vincent Price started a lot of hammer or horror films in the 60s. Great. He was born right in St. Louis. His grandfather invested in a confectionery. He called Vincent Price's sugar. It just became a multi-millionaire and could afford to send Vincent to Yale. He was going to go to Washington University, but he went to Yale. He studied art history, art English, but his passion was not. He always said, I know, I'm not an artist, but acting is the money for to build a collection of art. And that's what he's done. By the way, the Oakland Community College in California has the world's largest collection of art for community college, which is pretty tough. When he passed away, we donated his beautiful art collection. He was actually a very one-woman man, too. Heard that from his daughter. He assessed not being there. This here, was very influential, and he would broadcast it from our museum here at the St. Louis City Art Museum. There's an area where this is situated on, and the art aptly called Art Hill. So you see the arts around me. Art Hill, this is Hammer Hill. Okay, I'm here. My background, I'm a designer. A year and a half in factory. Best thing I ever checked. You know, as I tell you, a car you collect a payment. And that part of it was my LIFOR payment. It taught me a good lesson. Hey, did billboard. Probably, and I mean, sign, industrial business signs. I made a lot of these signs for textiles. The auto company to do that. The contractors had the bachelor in to sign the side of the blueprint roll. To call guys that like you, but you go back to your college. We said we're successful, but we don't want to say good anymore. Thank those people. The other thing is for the when I got a group of graduates. The other thing I did at undergrad is a school for the first day in paint. I went to Scotland, traveled Europe, Germany, first time, so on to London, England, France, Holland, Israel, and there's also the trip with that. Spent 2 years. I didn't go. So after that, school. I was 20 jobs. I went to Penn, right to grad school. But 6 when I'm 7 in the state, and 2 were in my own. What their fan is. In 1989 school, I'm MFA. And taught in Susan there. It's nationwide. Since the C's, one. I met my wife. We have a lawyer. We've been married together in 1980, 40. I've passed the great years, and in part. And I've come to has been to me, Jews. I work in a poet and abstract philosophism. Direction is gone from I've had action to real in both active so because of what you do, a toe hold as long as you world some integrity. It doesn't matter any doing art or have to do it with an element and sincerity. You know, once you shove absolutely the old saying, put your father kind of like that back and once you forward and there's no turn. My job's just moving in a factor, giant one of the crib all work in a year on minute machines, shoes New York back in time. When we mustn't, were looked and believed I'm a favored man. Machine, Charles Innocent, a photographer, BSA, and Drew Pine, was commissioned. Sheeler and his famous career to support more craftsmen. We're in a huge plant series in Michigan. Company. Look at this Rouge machine and man in it.
hand.
The size of this, and there's something embedded in this almost amazing here to drive machines in the printing mode industry. The quote straight here is central. It was something, an objective resting graph. One age in the United States, not being in style, before other style, machining, plural, the States itself, actually, or marketing sales and phrases. European art came from designers, logo in America. When American artists age, just looked art and design, not the that made the machining. It was an overwhelming fact in American and Dutch had production. The old rounded it was in the equestrial, so compelled to set up a hands of a Ford vision between rationalized mechanization and productivity. There was almost a religious fervor in the air about this era, and it seems to be affirmed by many, including one Enrico Trampolini, an Italian futurist painter from 1922, in an article called The Groom. Trampolini is quoted from his book, The Aesthetics of Machine and Mechanical Introspection in Art. Is not the machine today the most exuberant symbol of the mystery of human creation? Is not the new mythical deity which weaves the legends and histories of the contemporary drama. The machine in its practical and material function comes to have to us today in human concepts and thoughts the significance of an ideal and inspiration. The 19th century, although an inventive age, still seems stodgy and out of date. As the dawn of the 20th century with the advent of air flight, faster trains and automobiles, and the phenomenon of mechanized culture, comes an aura of progression. One would not wish to go backward to the good old days, only forward in this new renaissance of the analog technological development. With the outbreak of World War I, the first truly mechanized war, let me just cite plans here, you should really watch thoroughly The Shock of the New if you've never watched it with Robert Hughes. He talks about the loss of British soldiers in World War I. So many young men died in that war. I mean, it almost wiped out practically most of the army. Pretty amazing. The outbreak of World War I, the truly mechanized war, mechanized slaughter shocks the most patriotic and hardened soldier. Previously, war was fought gentleman against gentleman in open fields with sword or musket. Now the machine gun, a rapid-fire killing machine, made its debut. The German artist Otto Dix served the German army and drew during and after battles he participated in. He later became a pacifist, but drew a drawing entitled Falling Ranks, which depicted soldiers ripped apart by machine gun fire. This is his abstract drawing. I think this has more feeling than a realist drawing would, because it almost shows action of that situation. Anybody ever see War Horse, the Steven Spielberg movie? An interesting scene where the British cavalry says charge with their sabers, and they slaughter a bunch of Germans in their encampment. And later, as they get deep into the forest, the machine gun comes up, rips them to shreds. And the horror on their face was like that. I mean, that set volumes right there. We knew that things were going to change. Another artist, Paul Nash, and it's interesting when I visited Australia when my wife was. Going to school there full-time. Paul Nash served in World War I, and it's an interesting thing. I think the aspect of aftermath is not talked about too much. We've seen illustrations of war and disaster, but sometimes we don't see the aftermath of war, you know, where there's smoke still going and so on and so forth. And Paul Nash depicts the scene here, quite abstractly here, but pretty earnestly. Let me read this. When day dawned, we were astonished to see by degrees what a sight surrounded us in enormous shell holes filled with pieces of uniform, weapons, and dead bodies.